to see you this wonderful Sunday morning. Good to be back with you. Told the choir, I think I've got a double shot of energy this morning. Vacation. And yes, I can't deny it. The victory over Alabama is certainly feeding into this thing. So, anyway, we'll try to resist getting caught up on that. But anyway, notice the announcements there. A couple of important things. Let's see. We'll have five Sundays this month. So we'll have the Lord's Supper next Sunday, and then we'll have a fifth Sunday. It's not showing up on there, but we'll, our plan is to have a fifth Sunday fellowship here in a couple of weeks. But we delay our normal monthly fellowship meal until this Wednesday. Normally happens on the 2nd, but this we'll do it this week since a good percentage of the ones who are regularly there were out. So we'll meet at 6 o'clock Wednesday and enjoy that meal together and all. So on Friday morning, our men's group will, for a while now, we've been taking generally making it quarterly meeting. I believe enough of us will be together that we can kind of get that in the books and go over some things we need to on Friday morning at 8 a.m. So the quarterly joint meeting of the elders and deacons, 8 a.m. Friday morning. With that, I think that'll do it. I'll probably over the next few days kind of catch up on some of our prayer concerns and put out some messages regarding folks and how they're doing and all that. So, anyway. With that, I just realized, I don't know why, I thought I had hit the button. Mike and Linda will have a hard time seeing their pages if I don't figure out how to get that spotlight on. So I'm going to figure that out. But while we're doing that, let's just take a minute for our hearts for worship. Exalt the Lord our God and worship at His holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. We gather not just for ourselves, although there's many benefits to our gathering. It's good for us. God does something for us and with us when He calls us to assemble. But let us not make it all about us. Let us make it about the one who has called us, who has loved us, who has created us, and redeemed us in Jesus Christ. Let us worship the Lord our God, for He is holy. Boy, something happened from the beginning of our vacation week to the end of the vacation week. It's as if a painter showed up all over the place to make this masterpiece all around us in this beautiful place. And actually, there is a great artist who decorates all creation. How about we sing 116 as our hymn of praise for the beauty of the earth? We'll stand together. 116.
Amen.
causes us in humility and in awe to come before you and sing our praise. We pray that many more in this world will look around and recognize your eternal power, divine nature that's evident in all that you have made. And we pray that not only today would we celebrate and rejoice in what is seen in creation, but we'd also rejoice in our redemption in Jesus Christ. Teach us and instruct us of the beauty and the glory that it is to be those who have been forgiven, having our sins pardoned completely, not by virtue of anything we have done, but by virtue of what Christ has done for us. So teach us today of his love to us, your love to us, and all that he's done for us. And strengthen our hearts that we may stand firm to the end. For we lift up our prayer and our praise to you in through Christ our Lord. Amen. If you'll turn to page 875, I'm going to use a couple of the catechism questions as our confession. There's two of them, 86 and 87. Relative to our faith in Christ and who he is as our Redeemer and Savior. And catechism is an instructive tool. However, we're instructed in our church that this is certainly an appropriate way, like a corporate confession. A corporate and public confession of faith is a way in which we join together, encouraging one another in our faith in Christ. So I'll read the questions, we'll together read the answers. 86 and 87. Let's flip to the next page there on my second question. Let us confess our faith together. What is faith in Jesus Christ?
Faith in Jesus Christ is the saving grace whereby we receive and rest upon him alone for salvation as he is offered to us in the gospel.
What is repentance unto life?
Repentance unto life is the saving grace, whereby the sinner, out of the true sense of his sin, and apprehension of the mercy of God in Christ, does with grief and hatred of his sins, turn from it unto God, with the full purpose of, and ever after, the will of Jesus.
Amen. You may be seated. And hold your hymnals on page 786 is a responsive reading of Psalm 4. 786 is the page number. In a couple of the places in the scriptures, Exodus 34, as well as a number of the Psalms, and even may remember in when we look at Micah, there was an expression God is said to be slow to anger, abounding in covenant love, ready to show mercy. Mercy is a concept. It's very related to grace, but it's a little different in that mercy is a matter of looking upon those who are helpless So, to some degree, there's a sense that in our distress and our trouble, the Lord looks upon us with mercy, and the scriptures are filled with the expressions to assure us of that. Perhaps you'll find that kind of assurance here. So, let's read responsibly. I'll read the light print and respond with bold. This is the word of the Lord. Answer me when I call to you, O my righteous God.
You give me relief from my distress. Be merciful to me and hear my prayer.
How long, O men, will you turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods?
None of the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord will hear.
In your anger, do not sin. When you're on your beds, search your hearts. Be silent.
Love the right sacrifices and trust in the Lord.
have filled my heart with greater joy than when their grain and new wine abound.
I know I am sleep in peace, for you alone, O Lord, may me dwell in safety.
The Lord add his blessing, reading, the understanding, of course, the application, the reception of this, may we be able to say the same, that in our distress and in our struggle, we know that the Lord has allowed us to lay down in peace and find his security from him. Of course, all of this is made known to us, secure in the working of the Lord Jesus. 170 will be our hymn of affirmation. 170, Fairest, Lord Jesus, you may see it as we sing and find comfort in Fairest, Lord Jesus. that to yourself all day. So. Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we are grateful for the marvelous privilege that it is to come before you, to bring our requests, lift up our petitions and supplications. We also realize there's a great responsibility for us to ascribe to you glory and honor and praise. And so we pray that you'll help us as we pray to not only build into the wants and the asking, but to also be quick and ready to praise you, to offer our prayers with thanksgiving, which is a way of just acknowledging that you are good and you care for us in many ways. Today we do want to express our gratitude. We know that there are so many ways in which you have blessed your people here in this place, and you have cared for us. You have healed us. You have strengthened us for challenges. You have equipped us to deal with temptation. You have enabled us to show Christian love. And you have given us a ministry and a concern for others. And I see the evidence of that. And praise you for that. Praise you for the way in which your Spirit's working in us and leading us in that way. We desire to serve you more, and we would pray that you grant us your wisdom to know how we may do that. Help us to not be discouraged of being small, for even Jesus, the Savior, came from very small beginnings. He taught us that the kingdom is like a mustard seed, the smallest of all, and yet it has a tremendous impact. That the kingdom spreads like leaven in the dough. It can't be perceived, and yet it has its powerful effect. Well, we know that truth, but it can be discouraging. It's also discouraging to consider the way things are in the world in which we live, that there seems to be such resistance or opposition, but maybe even more serious is the apathy toward you. And we would pray that you move by your Spirit to wake up the people of this era and time. We would pray for opportunities, not only through what we do and how we do it, but also what we say, to put before them you, the truth of who you are and what you have done, and especially Jesus Christ. Help us not only to let our light so shine before men that they glorify our Father in heaven, but help us to speak up and to say to them what they should hear at times when you would move us and prepare us to do so, those divine appointments. Help us to reflect a life of faith and trust, and that can be attractive. Especially at a time when people suffer so many things and are subject to so many struggles. Make that not only make the gospel known through the proclamation, but we would pray that you make the gospel known and the power of it evident in the fruit of our lives, your people everywhere. So we lift that up to you, thanking you for all the great privilege that it is to be among number among your family, children of God, your faith in Christ. We do want to pray for those who have special challenges, afflictions, and difficulties. We have some who it's just very difficult to leave the house and to be here with us. And they deal with aging infirmity, and it's an evident and ongoing challenge. And we pray for them. We pray for those who care for them and assist them, and that you would provide them strength, that your grace and something of the gospel would be evident even in those types of situations. Help us to continue to pray for them and prompt us not only to pray for those special needs, but those ongoing challenges of our brethren. Some have had sickness lately, and we've asked for your complete healing and strengthening. We pray that as we enter into the fall and winter months, that you protect our people from the infectious disease that will be out there. And we would pray that you keep us healthy and strong, that we may serve you well. We thank you that we got good reports and your care over those that we've been praying for, and ask that you continue to hear us. Lord God, we also are grateful for the evident, beautiful, artistic, and aesthetic way in which you made this world. At this time of the year, we get to take notice of the beauty of it in a unique way. Colors and the changing of the season, and we would pray that you open our eyes to that and help us to share that beauty with others as well. We love you, thank you, praise you for every good thing we have in Christ, and pray that you will hear our prayers today and continue to lead us by your Spirit and answer us according to your good will, and glorify yourself in this church family. We lift all these things up and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's see. Okay, 189 is our offertory hymn. I think you know this one. We'll sing 1 and 4 as the ushers come and we worship through the giving of our tithes and offering. Do you need somebody, Mark, to help you out? Oh, you got it. Okay, good. 1 and 4, 189. Let me mention something. I had to see my other note here. It feels was like, I used to just remember everything and never forget to do whatever I needed to do. But now, even when I write it down, I forget it. Mike has shared with us the adult class his sister Carol. We will put this out in an email and remind you to pray for her. She seems to be okay right now, but she evidently had a medical event and ends up going to have a pacemaker put in and all these sorts of things, which obviously it's nice to know she's in a good place, but I appreciate the prayers for her. And anyway, we will do that. Just we were singing that Jesus loves me. This I know. I know that at least one very famous theologian, I think, was making a tour across America, a European theologian, very noteworthy. And there was some press conference somewhere, because he had visited somewhere to do lectures, and somebody asked him, what's the most important thing somebody needs to know about theology? And somebody was reading volumes and volumes and volumes, and said, I think the thing that you probably need to know most about theology is found in this little song that I heard here. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. And it was a simple phrase that evidently was seen as very profound when stated. I think I've heard of multiple people using that answer one time or another. What seems like, again, often we use it and sing it as a children's song. Did Jesus say something about that? He said, aren't those who will humble themselves and be like children are the only ones who will enter the kingdom? So, it's a simple, trusting faith, humble faith. All right, Hebrews 4. I don't know. I mean, I know we broke it up last week. Had Kurt Stapleton here. Ron and I didn't get together the other day. He catched me up on how things went and all that. But 2 weeks before that, kind of had a sermon on, it's about sin. Sin is one thing, and sinners. How does Jesus respond to sinners? Today, you'll see, same idea. What does Jesus do for sinners, or what Jesus does for sinners? I guess the way it stated there. And in the evangelical world, sometimes your strengths and also the place where your weaknesses can lie. I believe one of the strengths is a balanced faith, a balanced understanding that is serious about what God has revealed, especially what God has revealed to be right and wrong about the law of God. However, if we don't allow that to dominate, because that's not all God has done. He hasn't only revealed the law. He's also sent His Son. And so there's the balance of God's law that guides us and lets us know what's right and wrong. It also lets us know we're sinners. But then God hasn't abandoned us and left us on our own to try to deal with that. He has sent His Son to do everything necessary to reconcile us to Him. The gospel is that message that announces this good news, that while we are sinners and separated, Christ has come to do that which is necessary to redeem us and to bring us near. And there's obviously many aspects of that. But there's the strength of that is the weakness may be that because we don't intend to, but we can get hung up, we can easily, even though we know there's this gospel truth that God sending His Son to bring salvation, we can easily, because we look into the world and see the advancements of an antinomian. Okay, what does that word mean? It's a fancy theological term meaning against the law. There's a lawlessness that prevails. You all feel it just as well as I do, even now. Just watch the news. There'll be a number of expressions or things within that whole presentation, read an article that tells us that, wait a minute, our society and a number of people, it's not only that they don't have a regard for it, but they're actually advancing ideas that are completely contrary to what God has said is right and wrong. But what that does is it causes us to flare up this kind of, I think, righteous indignation. There's nothing wrong with that. But then, what do we do with that? Are we just going to get angry? Are we just going to be angry Christians? You know, like make sure everybody knows we're angry? Because we do that our strength of being firm and finding that the law still has a very significant place in God's revelation, that can become our greatest weakness. Then we will move into the realm of what we often refer to as legalists, meaning that God's blessing will only be observed through this legal observation and fulfillment of the law that we carry out in ourselves. And when you know the scripture, you know the law, that's impossible. I mean, if that could be done, Paul said so as much. He said, if a law could be revealed that could bring righteousness, Christ came for nothing. Why did he even come? Why did he come on the earth? We are unable to fulfill that. We need Christ. We have to have Christ to fulfill all. We have to have Christ to pay the penalty, and then we're recipients of that. Now, he's doing something in us to enable us to live that righteousness out by living according to God's revealed law and word. So it's a balance, but we have to be careful not to let. And why did I tell you all that? I guess what I'm trying to say is that if we're to do things well, I believe, live out our Christian lives and represent ourselves well, we can't let the righteous indignation lead us to this just becoming an angry. An angry Christian can be a very unattractive witness. And perhaps even just contrary to what Christ wants. I mean, read the fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness. If that's the fruit of our Christian lives, then an angry Christian can be a real problem. It can be a problem for witness. It can be a problem for ourselves. But I don't know if you feel it like I do. It seemed like as I've studied various things, when I said a few weeks ago, how did Jesus feel? He sat and ate with them. Who was he angry at? He was angry at the self-righteous. But he sat to eat with sinners. It's something I think I'm learning, and I'm going to have to learn. If the Lord tarries, he evidently wasn't ready to take me out of here yet. I hope I have a lengthy ministry if he tarries. There's something I need to learn, and we all need to learn, about living faithfully and representing Christ well, in a world that is clearly often very antagonistic to what we hold to. And when I read it, I realize it's not an issue of simply being angry and standing firm and yelling back at the other side and trying to, you know, win the arguments. Jesus has a different thing for us. He displays that, doesn't it? So I'm really giving you a rationale for why here you have a couple of sermons in a row about sin, sinners, and Jesus and sinners, as well as just to try to take on and ask the Lord to use this to mold us to reflect more of Christ in our own responses, in our own way. Okay, that's a long introduction. Let me get to the text here. 4:14. So, Jesus' attitude to sinners was not that he wanted to distance himself or be angry at them. Rather, he sought them out to interact with them. If he got angry, he was always angry with the ones who were so cocksure of themselves and their righteousness before God. That stirred his anger. He has not left us to deal with ourselves. Jesus himself has taken on sin. That is the gospel. Now, what does he do? So, it's going into that a little further. Jesus, the great high priest, is the heading I'm looking at. Hebrews 4:14. The word of the Lord. I'll read down to 5:9. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who is gone through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses. But we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet was without sin. Let us then approach the throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Every high priest is selected from among men, is appointed to represent them in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. This is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins, as well as for the sins of the people. No one takes this honor upon himself. He must be called by God, just as Aaron was. So Christ also did not take upon himself the glory of becoming a high priest. But God said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." And he says in another place, "You are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek." During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. This ends the reading of God's holy word. May the Lord bless us. Reading and the exposition to our edification and our sanctification. Melchizedek is introduced there, but I didn't want to get too much into Melchizedek. This one gets you distracted. If you get off on that and keep reading, you're going to be caught up in the Melchizedek thing. Although it does introduce it, and essentially, it's an order of the priesthood that is beyond that which was identified with Aaron in the Levitical priesthood of the Old Testament. Melchizedek was a figure that he didn't stand in that same line, and he wasn't called that same way. It was different, and he was the one who received all kind of worship and offerings and tithes from Abraham, the patriarch of covenant faith. And so Jesus comes. He represents more of this eternal and priesthood, not to be limited by the ways that the Levitical priesthood was. Something of that nature. That's all I'm going to give you today on him. Here's what Jesus does for sinners. He has come to serve as our great high priest. And then that just blow you away right there and say, "Oh, what are you talking about?" Well, let's see if the text helps us out a little bit. Yes, when you're studying the Old Testament and you read the regulations and restrictions, and then Aaron, his sons, and the Levites that came later, and you realize they had a special role. They had an important role to carry out all the requirements within the tabernacle, later the temple, to carry out the sacrificial system. They had requirements to know, to study, and to proclaim and teach the law to the people. They, in essence, you saw all over this in the reading there at the beginning of chapter 5, the priests would basically represent God before the people and represent the people before God. They're intermediaries there. And so they, obviously, as they represent the people of God, they did things like lay hands on the animal sacrifices and slaughter the animals and sprinkle and spread the blood and burn the portions on the altars. And, of course, if you were to go to Leviticus 16, you learn about that very, very important single day of the year. Every day was filled with sacrifices. But that one special day of the year, the Day of Atonement, was that time in which the high priest, the priest over all the other priests, would carry out this most sacred of sacrifices, in which he had to do all the stuff to prepare himself. Terms of not only atonement for himself and preparedness, but but also they had to go through the very specific restrictions to carry out the sacrifices. And on that day, that was the one and only day in which the high priest would enter into the most holy of places, the Holy of Holies. In that tabernacle or temple complex, there was the courtyard, and then you had the holy place, then you had the Holy of Holies. And then the Holy of Holies was the Ark of the Covenant, and on that day is when he would go in and sprinkle the blood of the sacrifice on that atonement cover. And that single day, that day was to represent this full and complete atonement that God was offering to the people through their faith, really. I would even go so far as to say, after I read Romans 4, that Paul makes very clear that though they weren't saved by their performance of anything, their performance of the law, whether sacrificial or moral or the civil way it was operated, was simply an expression of faith in God and trusting and believing what he revealed to them. So I think even the tabernacle and temple is salvation by faith. That we believe God enough that we're going to do what he's told us to do in the way he's told us. And the sacrificial system continued the same as by grace, because you know what you really deserve? You know what your sins deserve? Just look at these animals. That's what it deserves. But we're going to let them stand in your place. And we're going to let the high priest go in once a year and sprinkle the blood. And then the regular ongoing sacrifices are showing God's evident mercy and grace extended to you at all times, that you receive by trusting and believing him and obeying what he said. Well, that's kind of the picture here. That's what's being spoken of. Jesus, when he comes as the Son of God and as the Messiah, the anointed, he was anointed what? He was anointed prophet, priest, and king. Today, the emphasis is on the priesthood. He's anointed as the great high priest. What was pictured and depicted and represented in that Old Testament high priest has been fulfilled and superseded and completed and brought to its fullest expression in the coming of Jesus Christ. He is the great high priest. Now, if you want to read more about it, just read over chapters 3 through 10 in Hebrews a couple times today, and I think you'll get the point. Jesus is that great high priest. So why does that comfort us in saying what it does for sinners? Well, let's see what it said. It starts out the reading in verse 4. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who's gone through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold firmly to the faith we profess. See that? There's actually the first verse of this is showing that there's an application. And knowing Jesus as our great high priest has the benefits of edification of imparting to us something that will strengthen our faith to stand firm and hold firmly to it. Whenever we're told in Scripture to hold firm and stand firm, I don't think it has in mind faith in a vacuum. You know, faith where there's nothing to affect it. It's usually in the context of something that could cause you not to stand firm or hold firm. That could be direct opposition. It could be persecution. It could be, challenges to this faith. It could be the circumstances of life that bring a challenge. It's when you're told that this will help you in holding firm to the faith, it's in the context of something that could cause your faith to falter or to weaken or to stumble, etc. So you see, even in this context here, there's an applied truth. This isn't just theology. Okay, you don't read this section of Hebrews just so you can say some things about Jesus, to write them down in theological propositions. It's actually very much applied theology. You have a high priest, and this high priest enables you, and knowing him as your high priest enables you to stand firm and hold firm on this. What are the things he does? Well, first of all, you would know, if we were to open up our catechism and look that up, you it says some things about Jesus fulfilling certain offices. One of them, of course, those three offices are prophet, priest, and king. Those things that are depicted in the offices that God set up in the Old Testament to carry authority in different realms with his Old Testament covenant people, Jesus comes to fulfill all of those offices at a higher level, at a spiritual level, at a deeper level. You would see that how this, this question 25, page 871, if you want to look it up, if you don't trust my reading, Christ executes the office of a priest in his once offering up of himself a sacrifice to satisfy divine justice and reconcile us to God and in making continual intercession for us. So there's two things. His sacrificial atoning offering of himself and his continuing to intercede that's going on now. By the way, think about that. You're sitting here. I'm struggling through getting through the sermon. I'm not really struggling, but I'm trying to, just in a human way, get through and say what I want to say and get you there and try to make the points of what this is saying so that it will be edifying to you. Jesus is interceding for me right now. You're sitting there trying to keep your mind. Okay, what's he trying to say? I wish you'd explain that because that's kind of confusing. Hey, you're trying to get a little hungry. The human elements are all part of our going through, but Jesus is actually interceding for you right now. To bring that very personally and to think about that, that's what I'm trying to do, is get you to think about how that is happening. He's interceding with the Father. Help him pay attention. They're one of mine. Look, I lay down my life for those right there. Let's pour out our blessings on them. Let's give them our spirit. Let's give them the spirit to help prompt their life and their attention. Let's edify them and sanctify them in the truth. He's doing that for us right now. And this week, when you face those struggles, he'll be doing it then. Oh, well, the intercession, what evident here, one of the things, in fact, there's one thing I just realized in studying this, that catechism, I'm not going to say the catechism question can be made better. That sounds very arrogant. But there's an aspect of this that I want to point to. But first, it's very clear. In chapter 5, verse 2, what's the high priest's purpose? What is his function? He's selected from among men and is appointed to represent men in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. That's one thing Jesus did, has done for sinners. He offered himself for sin. There's only two options. There's really only two options. Either you have to have a way, you have to deal with your own sins, or God must provide a substitute. Remember Abraham? Either God is it? It's one of the first very vivid pictures of the way God is going to bring redemption. I've called you, Abraham. I've got you as my covenant man. After you waited all this time, I'll give you a son. Now he's going to go give you. He gave him a commandment to go kill his son. Offer him a sacrifice. And Moses, we know it was a test. It was a test of faith. But what did God do? Did Abraham still have to give the sacrifice? Yes. But God provided a substitute for the sacrifice. A picture, an illustration of what was coming when he sent his son. Abram's one and only son, the son he loves, was spared. God's son, the one who he loves, was not spared. He was presented as that sacrifice. Jesus is the great high priest. He offered himself. You keep reading, you find out what's different about his sacrifice. The reason we no longer observe any other sacrifices is because his was the full and the complete and the final sacrifice. It was effective once for all. In fact, that's a major point that Hebrews is making. The fact that those others had to be repeated, even the Day of Atonement was repeated every year, as marvelous as it was for the people, is repeated If something is repeated, it's either temporary, kind of like eating. You know, that meal you have in a little bit, it's only going to go so long, and then you got to eat again. Or it's incomplete. It's incomplete. Something has to be done again to make it keep going. It's consumed up. Its effects it's exhausted. It has to be done. It's like the gas in a car. It's going to be consumed, and then you got to put more in. There's never a point where you just put it in and it lasts forever. When Christ came as once for all, that's what he's done for sinners. Our conscience can be cleared because this once and for all sacrifice was given for us. That's the first one. Now here's the other. And this is the thing. The intercession part of the catechism question probably incorporates this. But if it was made more explicit, that's where it would help us. Here's the other thing he does for sinners. And I would say that this is primarily for redeemed sinners. But for someone who hasn't come to faith in Jesus Christ and made that known, this ought to be a really attractive thing. This ought to be something that ought to get their attention. He helps us. He helps us. Where do I get that? In chapter 5, when they started talking about high priests or priests in general, you have to be careful because it wasn't talking about the way Jesus didn't have to make a sacrifice for his own, you know, atonement and preparation. He was morally pure. But what it didn't say, as it went on to kind of make the application to Jesus, it didn't say he had to do something for his sins, but he did say he identifies with our weakness. In his coming to earth and becoming a human, he understands and knows the frailty and the difficulty and the challenge and the struggle that it is to be a human being walking and living on this earth. And because he knows it, he's one who understands, has mercy and compassion, and is there to help. Notice that statement. Verse 15 in chapter 4, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are. Here without sin. Then let us approach the throne of grace. Notice that. This isn't just making a theological statement about Jesus' sinlessness and his identification with human experience. After stating that, it says what? Approach the throne of grace. Go to God in faithful prayer. And do so knowing that you're going to receive grace with confidence. So that what? We may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. This incredible theological, high Christological, theological verse ends with saying, here's why this is important. Because when you find yourself needy and weak and struggling, you have a place to find help. It's very pastoral and practical. Jesus, the great high priest, continues to intercede in order to impart a merciful and compassionate and helpful ministry to us as we live out our days in this fallen and sinful and struggling and sometimes very cruel and harsh life in this world. Now, I don't know what you really want. What you're longing for is glory. I am. I long for glory every morning when I stand up and my ankles, my knees hurt so bad. I'm like, I don't think I want people to walk in that. I'm longing for glory, obviously. I was longing for glory a few months ago. Why am I going through this? We're longing for glory when we're terrified of the things that can happen to our children and grandchildren. We're longing for glory when we read and hear the news and see that there's such a lawlessness or an antagonism toward God and His truth and His word. What do we want? What do I mean by that? We're wanting Christ to come, do away with His enemies, transform the world, and bring in the glorious outcome, where there are no more pain, no more tears, no more death, no more frustration. It's all going to be harmonious, shalom, peace, glory with Christ, with God. But for whatever reasons, in God's wisdom, He is leaving it this way for a time. But He hasn't left us without help. He's given us a high priest who not only gave Himself in sacrifice for sin, but He's there always to help us in our time of need. You read through this, you see that there. It's like these things that we point, these would be the texts that I go to if I was just doing a theological summary of who Jesus is and, you know, His offices and His role and His purpose as Savior and Messiah. But there's a very clear application. Christians, you have hope to find help to endure and hold firm in your faith in this world that can be so infuriating, so disappointing, so scary, because you have a high priest. His name is Jesus, the Son of God, who come to earth. So his ministry, for his priestly ministry, wasn't ended. And it's not even being carried on in heaven. It's actually being imparted also when, through the Spirit, He guides us and helps us along the way to alleviate our anxieties and fears in the face of those things that scare us to death, who strengthen us to still be faithful to God in the face of those things that are so ugly and nasty, as and those ones who might be enemies of God. So that's the thing. Jesus had compassion for sinners. He sat and ate with them. He wanted to reveal to them the mercy of God when he had in His earthly ministry. And He's still there to help sinners in His heavenly ministry now. Christians find hope and encouragement in that. And just as it says, go to the throne of grace. I don't want to read one other passage, chapter 12, the first few verses. Listen to this. And I know we'll do a pretty good today, in spite of the fact that they keep moving that clock up. Hebrews 12. Now, Jesus the high priest is there to help. So go to the throne of grace. That means go to Him in prayer. Go to Him in planned prayer. Go to Him in spontaneous, desperate prayer. Whatever. It doesn't matter. Just go to the throne of grace. It's a throne of grace, meaning grace is dispensed there. And as we see, what that means is that the mercy and the help of God is through Christ, part of the working of the Spirit. What about chapter 12? I think knowing Him as the great high priest, the one who's done all this, the once for all sacrifice, the interceding, etc., all that He does for us as redeemed sinners, but sinners nonetheless. Take notice of how it brings us to this exhortation and encouragement in Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. Now, that, you'll have to read chapter 11 to see what this great cloud of witnesses is. It's the hall of fame of faith from the Old Testament. The examples of trust in God that are listed there. Since we're surrounded, since we have such a cloud of witnesses, people who we can look to and to learn from their faithful example, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Have you ever found encouragement from reflecting on another faithful Christian's life? Now that faithful Christian who you admire and you said a believer, they have their own struggles and they have the Lord is at work in their life too. However, God is using them whether they know it or not, and you find encouragement by observing their Christian life, faith, obedience, etc. And that's in here. You can find encouragement. But what does it say? You see there, you see what their witness to Christ and faithfulness to Him. Now, let that encourage you to throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. In other words, let that be something that prompts you to remove and rid yourself of those things that that prompts you towards sin, the temptations and the various other things are all part of that struggle. Let us throw off everything that hinders and sin that so easily tames, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Run with perseverance. We read that catechism. Faith in Jesus Christ. Receiving and resting on Jesus Christ alone as he is offered in the gospel. Or I've reordered that, but that's the essence of it. Receiving and resting. But that receiving and resting is a persevering, it's an ongoing trust and resting and receiving Christ throughout. It's enabled and equipped by working in the Spirit in us, but it's still a persevering faith that continues. Now look at verse 2. Let us remove the things that hinder, and let us what? Fix our eyes upon Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, okay? His priestly work, offer himself once for all for sin. Scorning of shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And he's not sitting there passively, by the way. He's not, we go with the pastimes that we, and the hobbies we get involved in. What's he doing? We just, chapter 7, verse 25 tells, he continually lives to intercede for us. He's interceding for us. He's praying for you. He's praying for me. He's lifting us up before the Father. And they are in mercy and grace, sending forth the Spirit to guide us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning and shame, sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. We could paraphrase this in its broader context and say, turn your eyes on the great high priest, who died and offered himself in an atoning death for your sins, but also is continually living to help you in this life, fallen, struggling, difficult life. He's there. So look to him. Go to him. Seek him. That's what it means to turn your eyes upon him. Fix your eyes on him. It's not talking about looking at something. It's like it's going to him. Is looking to his example, listening to his word, and seeking him to help us. He's the author, the one who has kind of devised it. He's the perfecter. He's the one who's completed, done the things to complete everything necessary. And that complete of the atonement was done, but the completing of what he has to do with you is still ongoing. He is doing that work in you. He's perfecting that in you. He's completing that work. Now you see why it's such an encouragement to know that Jesus has fulfilled the role and the office of the great high priest for his people. Let that be an encouragement to you to carry you on in this sometimes quite agonizing, frustrating, angering, infuriating life. Let us receive his mercy and grace in those times. So, we're going to encourage one another today to do this very thing. 481, first and last verse. I'll stand together as we sing 481. Turn your eyes upon Jesus and fall on his word.